The thoughts and opinions of this program are merely those of the hosts and the guests of the program. You are listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. I'm Jimmy Olsen. Rooster McRoberts with me. How are you, sir?
Doing good, Reverend. How about yourself?
Well, did
you have a good weekend? I did.
Not too bad. It wasn't a bad weekend. Yeah, I hear you spent at least 2 hours of it watching a Robin Williams special.
Yeah. Let's stay a little bit more upbeat at the beginning of the show. Then we might hit a negative there.
It was put together well.
It was well done. I don't know about the rest of y'all out there, but there are very few people. Well, let me put it this way. I didn't know Robin Williams. He's not a friend of mine. But here's a guy that made an impact, in my opinion, made an impact on those individuals that watched his movies, his TV shows, all the way back to the Mork and Mindy days.
Oh, he was hilarious. He was fantastic.
The guy was awesome. I mean, and just so much depth. He could do the comedian side, and then he could become so very serious in his methods. I mean, he was able to do far more, and they said it on the show, far more than any other comedian that's out there, ever been there or is there now and maybe into the future. And what's interesting to me is, as I'm sitting and watching this, and finally it registers, he passed away in 2014.
2 years ago.
2 years ago. Yeah.
Wow.
Absolutely. And I mean, it's as raw today as it was the very day that you found out about it. And the other thing is the deep appreciation. And I'm convinced these people are telling the truth on this show. Okay. They didn't just go on there and say, you know, yeah, we loved him. He was this, he was that just for the show. I'm convinced the folks that had things to say about him really meant it. And what's interesting is this level of individuals that had such love for him and appreciation for him. What makes it difficult, and I watch this, I mean, now we're really getting into this, okay, is the fact that I had a friend of mine that committed suicide last week.
Right.
And what a wonderful person he was. I'm not going to mention his name. It's nobody's business. But he was a wonderful guy. And to see somebody become so despondent and so depressed and where they feel that they have no other alternatives, there are no other options available other than taking their own life.
Right.
Makes me step back and wonder, as a human being, a part of the human race, am I doing enough? Am I paying attention to my friends to maybe see the signals? Listen, I'm not a trained psychiatrist, psychologist, a therapist in any way. I'm not that, but you know your friends, and you know when they take a left turn or a right turn, and their personalities change.
Right.
And I guess I'm a little mad right now because my friend had many friends around him, and again, to all of my other friends that I'm about to pour a bucket on you, throw you under the bus, tough crap, okay? I really don't care. But to look at a person like this and go, oh, he's just being, you know, negative Ned, or he's just, and his name wasn't Ned. He's just being a drama queen, as they call it.
Looking for attention.
Looking for attention.
I mean, all of those things. You know.
And just to say that and let it go, damn you.
Or, you know, they're just being a Debbie Downer.
We all have bad days.
Absolutely.
But still, I'm saying this, damn you.
Right.
I mean, why in God's name? I think, and I'm saying that to myself. So if I'm pushing this out to folks, I'm saying this to myself. Damn me.
Right.
What the hell's wrong with me? Why didn't I pay attention? Why didn't I look a little deeper? Why didn't I put my business to the side for 5 minutes?
Right.
Why didn't I put my priorities in the right place and go, can I help you? Can I help you find help? Let's talk. Let's have a cup of coffee. Now, a few people did do that. And again, I can't mention who they are. A few people did do that for our friend, but he got into that position. But for the ones that just pass over it,
right,
and don't care and right. go, it's just, again, a drama queen thing, the heck with you. Shame on you.
Right.
And what I feel personally, let me say this, I feel personally that if you think that there's a problem, I would rather err on the side of that they have a problem, I need to help them, and be wrong,
right,
than to err on the side that they're just having a damn bad day, and the next day I hear they're gone.
I know we're starting out a little somber on this one, but again, this is going to go into a conversation we're going to have a little later on in the show. And some things that we all have to remember, it doesn't matter if you are licensed or you have your degree. Being a friend, a lot of times it's just being that ear. Sometimes I just need somebody to talk to, and it can be as simple as that, so it doesn't turn into
I'm having a hard time reconciling with this. Most people that know me, I'm pretty hard. I mean, I can handle it.
Right.
But I'm really having a tough time reconciling this. Anyway, let's move on.
Yeah, we will come back to that in just a little bit. Listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster, and we are in the DebtProdigy.com studios. Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home or business finances on autopilot. So check them out at DebtProdigy.com. Sign up, get details. In fact, when you sign up, be sure you put in there that it was Jimmy Olson that made that reference for you. And then that way we get a little bit of credit, and you can get the details and things go on from there. So outside of that, did you make it to the movie theater to see any other movies over the weekend?
You know, I did not make it out to any movies. And let me say this. It is a pain in the butt to get Mrs. McRoberts to go to a movie. I mean, it is. That woman is a pain in the butt when it comes to doing that. I don't know who's been sitting in that chair. Did they leave something on there I don't want?
They probably did, but that's okay.
And the truth of the matter is, yeah, she's probably right on that. All them people all around me, she's not a very, very, she is certainly not very social, especially when you pile tons of people in a room.
Exactly.
They might sneeze on me. Or
they forgot to take a bath.
They stink, right? I mean, something like that. Now, what I did,
okay.
What I did in the McRoberts, home.
Domicile.
I had a friend of mine that owed me money. owed the old rooster some money, and I said, okay, we're going to do this. He was a brilliant guy, and knew how to build furniture and all this kind of stuff, and he built a theater room for me.
Oh,
and I have a 140-inch theater screen. The screen's 140-inch. So all you guys that have your man caves with your 60-inch plasma, bite me. I got 140 inches. So that's where we watch most of our movies.
So his compound is really the compound.
It is the compound. Yeah. I mean, seriously, that's so we don't do that. Mm-hmm. We watch our stuff at home.
Right.
Now, recently, we haven't really watched any movies. We're big old shows, old movies.
Mm-hmm.
In my case, I have basically two or three channels that I watch: the History Channel, the Travel Channel, A&E. Okay, I watch those three, and then if movies come on, let's face it, if it's seriously, I think I've watched The Shootist 5,000 times. Okay, I mean, I quote lines from The Shootist. I mean, it's that arguably the best movie John Wayne ever did. So
right. You
all out there don't like John Wayne.
That was his last movie, too, wasn't it?
Last movie, yeah. And everybody in that movie knew that he maybe had 6 months to live or some very short period of time.
Right.
So I mean, he makes a comment that he was sorry for saying something. That he's been operating on the raw edge. Well, I guess even in that movie, he's operating on the raw edge. But the fact of the matter is, I'm a big Western fan.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I like Westerns. I like war movies, too. But my area that I like the most are those films that are done based upon an actual event or a historical event.
Speaking of, there was one that made it into the that did make it in the countdown. Well, movies over the weekend. So you remember the
Go ahead. You remember the
movie Evil Dead?
Yeah.
You know, it was that very low budget. It was like $8,000, really.
Yeah,
it just turned into like this cult classic.
Yeah, cult classic.
I don't even know if I would even give it a B movie. It was like more of a Z movie.
Was it? Okay.
I mean, literally, it was like, so low budget horror movie. The people that created Evil Dead did another movie that they released over the weekend called Don't Breathe, number one movie over the weekend.
No kidding.
Number one, Suicide Squad fell down. Kubo and the Two Strings in the top five. Sausage Party still there. And,
oh, my God, Sausage Party. Why is Sausage Party even there? I just, you sick little weirdos.
And then Mechanic Resurrection, the new Jason Stratham movie. That also
I like him as an actor. He's a great action actor. Yeah.
So you heard about the movie South Side with You. That was the movie about how President Obama and Michelle met. Yeah, it didn't even crack the top 10.
Thank God.
I thought you would enjoy that. I thought I would share that.
Like, who the hell cares about that mess?
I'm sure you and Kirby enjoy that one right there.
Yeah, we actually do, don't we, Kirby? Right.
No, I meant that it didn't make the top 10.
Oh.
She's like cringing over there. It's like, you totally lost.
Have you not had your third cup of coffee yet, Kirby?
I can write it out in crayon if that would help.
Yeah, we write it out. Well, folks, it's a good thing that this is recorded, because if you saw what I just saw, well, we couldn't put it on the show. There we go.
You're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster, thanks to Dead Prodigy. Dead Prodigy helps you track all your spending and expenses, creates and manage your budget, manage all your financial account. Dead Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com to get details for that, and you can even sign up, and they'll give you updates as they're getting ready to launch. What? Did I say something wrong?
No, you didn't.
Okay, debtprodigy.com.
No, you did great.
Okay.
I interrupted you, didn't I?
No, you
didn't.
Fine.
I didn't even say a word. I just changed the way I look, folks. And
no, Jim, it was his breath of like, and I go, okay, did I read the script wrong?
You did great. You did great. We need to close the end on our negative kind of subject. Okay, we need to close the end on that. We need to close that up. We were being kind of solemn and somber.
Well, we'll get there.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, we'll get there.
I'm glad Reverend's in charge here, because I got no idea where we're traveling to. He's got the map. I'm just driving. You ever see that in your car? The wife's got the map. What's the husband's driving?
Actually, you know, isn't that kind of funny? I was reading something a few weeks back, and they're talking about a telephone book. Yeah. How many kids do not even know what a phone book is?
They have no clue.
And now with GPS in your phone, they don't even know what a map is.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, on your phone, yes, but how they have to open it up.
Do you remember when I used to do trips,
right,
driving to southern Missouri, driving to Colorado, and all these places, California, whatever, mm-hmm, when I drove, okay,
right,
a lot.
Now
you would go to AAA,
yes,
and you would order a trip tick. You ever heard of that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Kurt, we got children amongst us here. Triptych. And they would put together the most awesome package.
Yeah, I mean, it was like a bound little booklet
awesome
that they gave you.
Gave you all mapped out, the best,
yep,
directions in yellow. Then you all got coupons and, mm-hmm, brochures.
Yep.
And it was the neatest thing. And it was freaking free.
Yep, all you had to do was call them. And I bet you they probably still do.
I wonder how. You know what? I'd be curious to see how they have come into the 21st century, because AAA is still around.
22nd century.
It's the 21st.
We know we've moved to the 22nd with the new millennium.
What?
Yeah. Dude,
this
we
is
like
the 21st century. The 1900s is the 20th century. Yeah, and they call me a hillbilly. Seriously.
Hey,
don't
so do you
stuff
like crossword puzzles?
Yeah, occasionally.
And you know Steve Carell, he was in The Office as, you know, a comedian.
Yeah.
So he likes doing crossword puzzles too. He was doing one, you know, People Magazine has that crossword puzzle in there.
Yeah.
He was doing the People Magazine crossword puzzle and found out that they spelled his name wrong.
That's hilarious.
He goes, in fact, he tweets this or Instagram or something. He goes, was I cray? You know, crazy. Because I'm like putting it in there. He goes, this just doesn't look right. The Walking Dead. Do you ever watch that on AMC?
I have watched it probably twice. I've never been a zombie kind of guy. Like I said, it's war movies and cowboys.
Well,
and
same
Indians,
thing.
Right?
It's still a war movie. You're just fighting against the zombies.
Clearly not realistic in my mind. I do not believe the zombie apocalypse.
Well, NBC,
is imminent.
NBC was thinking about picking up The Walking Dead. They were going to do it, but they were going to change
NBC.
NBC,
but getting it off the cable channel.
But they were going to change how they were going to do it. They were going to turn it into more of a police procedural or a police drama, to where instead of, you know, them learning the survival skills to survive, you know, because of the zombie apocalypse, they were going to be solving the zombie crime of the week.
Oh, dear.
I think they were also going to change the name of that to Law and Order Zombie Unit.
That's ridiculous. That is stupid as heck. I cannot. And you know what? There'd be some fools out there. Man, this is great. This is great TV. No, it isn't. It sucks. God almighty. Let me tell you what. Seriously, that's just dumb. It's just dumb.
All right. Reese Witherspoon also said she's willing to do another Legally Blonde movie.
How old is she? 62?
I don't know. And she's done, well, they've done two.
Well, listen, I mean, she is a bit, tad bit older now.
No, she's about my age.
Okay, so she I didn't say she wasn't pretty. I just said, do we need another one? That's exactly, Ms. Kirby has said, we have a millennial here that's saying, no, we do not need another one of those. Okay, no, we don't. I mean, a sequel to that? No,
they've already have two. Technically, so, there's three, because there was a third one.
Are you
kidding? That it was her cousins, and I don't think that she was actually in it. So this really would be the fourth of the franchise. You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home or business finances on autopilot. DebtProdigy.com. Go there for all the details. And to sign up, you can sign up and get updates on where they are and how things are going when you do that and ask for referred. Put Jimmy Olsen in there so Rooster and I get credit for that. A couple more things before we get back to a little more serious. I know so there's some things that Rooster really wants to talk about today, which are really important that we want to get there. But just before we get there, there was a study done. Hey, so you remember going to school and that teacher you had the crush on? There might have been a few. So
think about this
for a minute.
Yeah.
What were your grades in that class?
They were fantastic.
Right.
I did very well.
So what they did in this study, they said they found that kids get better grades when they have a crush on their teacher. Or a good-looking teacher, you know, one that you would think is good-looking. So they get better grades when they have that than if they do not have a crush, which is, duh, they're paying attention. Hello.
They become the top of the class if they have sex with them, right? I mean, let's go past. Look, it's my theory on drinking wine, red wine. One glass is good for the heart. A bottle's got to be better. So does the same theory apply here in school? The 16-year-old's doing great. Let's do better.
The cops might have something to say.
Well, I think they probably would, but
that just turned into a bad.
Depends on whether you're from Iowa or Arkansas. Arkansas, it ain't no problem. I talked to Hillary and Billary.
So I mean, basically, really, what it is, you have a crush on this teacher, you're paying attention.
That's absolutely makes sense. Makes sense.
Yeah.
And I did. If you could see my English teacher, though, wow.
Right.
Whoa. Never mind. Let's move on.
Well, you know what they say.
I'm having visions.
Older women make beautiful lovers.
Yeah, but I probably get a picture of her now and go, oh, crap.
What was I thinking
back then?
All right. So here's something else. Oxford Dictionary, they were trying to find the world's most hated word. So they went to the internet, did a post, you know, hashtag, you know, what's the... they ended up having to shut it down because people were not playing very nicely in the sandbox.
They were putting...
It turned into more of racist type things rather than just...
What in the hell?
Yeah,
why? Is this world so full of dummies?
Oh!
Dummies.
All right, ready? Are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
I've been waiting. Okay, so a friend of mine posted this on Facebook today. You ready for this?
Yeah, I'm ready.
They said, when you're dead...
I'm still ready.
When you're dead, you don't even know you are dead. It's only pain for other people. Which is true. When you die, I mean, it's pain for friends and family. The same thing is when you're stupid. It's only a pain for other people because they got to put up with your stupid.
Ain't that the truth? Ain't that the truth? And you people are wearing my butt out. I got to go home and lay down because there's so many stupid people out there.
And as they end that, brilliant coworker.
Look. I still, somebody has to help me understand.
Okay.
Somebody has to help me understand how there can be people out there. Well, politics is the name of the game today, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what people are talking about. How is it that somebody, or this number of people out there, can be so enamored by Hillary Clinton with all of her stupid decisions that have been made? I mean, we can go through this list. I've posted it on Facebook before. I mean, this whole list of failure after failure after failure. It makes you wonder. Another guy's ended up dead here just a couple of weeks ago. It makes you wonder, how can you support somebody like that?
And people could bring back, I mean, now, not that Trump's been in that type of position to where, you know, well, I guess he could. He is in New York. I'm sure he knows some people. If you want someone to disappear.
Oh, I suspect
so. But again, I mean, he just shoots his mouth off. Sometimes I really want to wonder what things that he did. You think about that before you opened?
Well, there's been many times old Rooster said stuff and everybody around him going, what the hell was he thinking? I mean, I get that. But is that the same thing as giving out giving people the ability to look at some of our national secrets? Mm-hmm. Is that the same as not being there to help the folks in Benghazi that died? Is that the same thing as lying? Is it the same? My family's security is more important to me than whether or not Donald Trump took bankruptcy. And we've already discussed that in previous shows. Look, this woman is evil. An evil incarnate. I mean, she is an evil person. I mean, if there were a way to put horns on her head and paint her face red and put a tail on her, that would be appropriate. Now, again, let's look at Donald. Is he perfect? Hell no. Come on. I mean, you got anybody else that you can put up there that's perfect? No.
I just want the flag to be dropped. I mean, really, out of what, millions of people in this country, and this is who we get? Both sides. I want to just.
Well,
can we call a rematch?
It ain't going to happen.
I know
it ain't going to happen. I mean, there are individuals out there that are running for office that are still, you know, their names are being floated
right.
as independent. But the truth of the matter is, we are stuck with one or the other.
Oh, exactly.
At the end of the day. And I'm not saying I'm taking the lesser of two evils. I'm not going down that road. What I am saying is I'm taking the one that's got the best resume. Mm-hmm. And in my humble opinion, no, not even in my opinion, and I'm right, Donald Trump can run things. He understands a machine.
Well,
Hold on, I'm going to go with you first.
I mean, are we in a point now to where, because it's all about helping people, which we're going to get into that here in a little bit,
okay,
too.
Okay.
But when is it to the point that the country needs to try and be fixed before they can help anybody else? Like a business. If a business is going so far down to where they're not even able to pay their own bills, I mean, they're on their way to bankruptcy or closing, which, I mean, let's be honest, the way the government is right now, if a business has ran that long,
yep.
they would be gone. There's jobs.
They can't even balance their own checkbook.
Right. So at this point, when is it that they have to get their ducks in order to understand financial pieces before they can keep...
I think you've really hit the nail on the head. So who do you bring in to fix that? Do you bring in a career politician? I don't think so. Right. Do you bring somebody in there that's trying to feather their own nest? okay, financially? I don't think so. Do you bring somebody in there that really doesn't have a concern about the bottom line because in their position, the bottom line doesn't affect them?
Right.
There's no way. Look, here we're going to have Hillary, if she gets in. Now we got two people in the same household that are getting a paycheck for the rest of their lives.
Mm-hmm.
Look, it can happen. If she was qualified, and what I mean by, yeah, that's right. If she were qualified, I'd vote for her. It doesn't matter. The party lines do not matter to me. What matters to me clearly is who's there to get the job done. Who's going to step into that position? And we're talking about a country that we're in a terrible time financially. Businesses, as you mentioned, can't survive. They've been encumbered by governmental restraint. You've got to do this. You've got to do that to the point where we can't even move. And you need a business owner that understands a little theory here. It's called the theory or the velocity of money. If you reduce taxes, okay, if you take away the constraints of businesses, I mean, it's silly little things that cost extra dollars, okay? And we could go through the list, not important at this moment because everybody knows they can research and find it. But the fact of the matter is, if we can eliminate those, we create what's called the velocity of money. And that means the businesses have more money in their checking accounts. What are they going to do with that? Oh, sure, some owners are going to put more money in their pocket. Great. But the truth of the matter is, the overall position is that these companies then will put money back into their businesses because that's what small business people do, which means, guess what? I get to hire another employee. I get to expand my business. I got to buy more computers. I got to buy more equipment, which does what? Somebody had to put the damn computer together, right?
Well, you just hit something that people forget about so much, and because they always focus on corporate America and big business and, you know, how they're lining.
Sure, yeah.
But that's you actually hit something that no one ever talks about or thinks about during elections is the small business person.
Yeah, the little guys that are out there, the little gals that are out there that have small businesses, they're working their ass off.
And you're right. They're going to put it back in, and they're going to try and bring more people in to hire. But the other part, let's go to school for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a conversation that I had a couple weeks ago. I can't remember if we already talked about this or not. But let's actually, you remember your government economics class, right?
Unfortunately, yes, I do.
Okay, so
that was a boring
class. So honestly, here's where I'm going to go. I really do not care who's running for that seat because, let's be honest, we're going to sit here and tout our feathers of, well, they're the most powerful person in the world. Well, maybe in a position that they have no power in.
That's exactly right.
It's a figurehead position, so if something goes south in America or whatever it is, we have somebody to blame. If things go well, we have someone that gets to, you know, tout their own feathers because we're doing well. Yes, they have executive decision.
I get that.
They do have
executive
that.
Power.
But the reality is that doesn't get pulled off that often. Unless we end up getting a tyrant in there, and now it just became a dictatorship because, you know, nothing really matters. But the point is, it's Congress that makes the decisions. It's Congress that passes the laws. That is, so it's the person that's going to sit in that, and it's not even just them. Let's not even just look at the presidential side of this. Let's look at the vice president side of this.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're the ones that are going to actually be sitting in Congress,
mm-hmm.
and these are the ones that need, on both sides, president and vice president, to get both parties to work together. It's to the point now, it's not Republican versus Democrat. It's everybody against everybody because nobody is working with anyone right now. That's why nothing's getting through.
And I'm not, here's the unfortunate, everything that you said, you're absolutely right on. For you kiddies out there that don't know what Jimmy's talking about, it's called our system of checks and balances, okay? So you kids can look that up. Oh, yeah, go Google it. Don't go to the Britannica, all right? Do I need
the
to
world
tell you?
Book?
Do you all want to know what a Britannica? Never mind.
No, let's go back to World Book. Remember
World
Book?
Oh, good Lord.
My parents had World Book.
So did I.
Up.
Yeah, we did too. Yeah, World Book.
The door-to-door salesman.
Encyclopedia Britannica.
And y'all out going, what's that? I never heard of that.
I don't know.
Ever heard of a telephone? Well, I know what that is. I got one in my hand. I carry it all over the world. No, that's not what I'm talking about. Anyway, the point is, yeah, you're right, Jim. I mean, you absolutely are correct. So it gets back to, however, you need to add one last thing to it. I do believe that the president of the United States sets the tone.
Right.
Well, sets again, the tone.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right.
Now let's take this a step further. As my friend Brett Rogers would say, he cares who becomes president.
Mm-hmm.
But clearly, that's not the place that we need to focus.
Right.
Where we need to focus is on city government and then state government.
Mm-hmm.
If we can control the city government, and what I mean by control, get the folks in that we believe in, passionately are going to be there for our best interests, whatever those interests are, you have to really do this from the ground up, okay? Not from the top down, but from the ground up. City, state governments have to have the right kind of people in place, because when you think about it, guess where Washington gets Congress and the legislature, right?
Exactly.
For you kiddies that don't understand government, they come from the states, and they travel into Washington.
Your neighbor, basically, end up being.
That's exactly right. So if you want to affect a change in this country, stop focusing on the president so much and focus in your own community. And as Brett has shared in Texas, okay, put $5 a month away, whatever, help build a bank of dollars to help back that person that you want. And like Brett said, it's who you believe in. He's not saying, I want you to back the person. I'm saying, I have people that I'm backing, if you want to know who it is, right? Same way. But back the person that you believe in. Then we change this country.
As I say, take care of your backyard first.
That's it. Exactly.
And that's going to actually perfect segue into with the state conversation we're going to do. But before we get to that, you're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy helps you track all your spending and expenses, create and manage your budget, manage all your financial account. And Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com. Fill out the details there. They're going to keep you updated of how they're getting ready to launch their system, and you can put in there when it says referred by Jimmy Olson, and then that way Rooster and I get credit for what we are doing for the folks at Debt Prodigy, debtprodigy.com. So now we're, I guess, we probably will not be as somber as what we were earlier.
No,
we
I won't get that bad. No, go ahead.
But now, so as we open, we were talking about how you had been watching the documentary for Robin Williams over the weekend.
Right.
Before we, as we were getting ready to go today, we were actually having the conversation about people with, you know, depression or
mental health issues
comes up. So now we're talking about the state.
Right.
And for those that know, we are in Iowa. That's where the show comes from.
Right.
And over with the current governor, he's been closing mental health facilities. Again, now there's ways to look at it either way. People are going to gripe about it. But I mean, it was a financial decision. I mean, again, if you do not you build a house, you do not maintain that house. Guess what? It falls apart. Number one. Number two, it still takes money to hire the staff to take care of the people in the facility. If you're not able to do that, again, it still comes to a financial decision, a financial issue. So a person being in a position to make a call, they take the good and the bad with the decision that they make. But at times, you have to make a business decision. Financially.
Okay.
But now we have to look to the other side of this. What do you do with the people that need that help? What do you do with the people that have those mental health issues?
Okay, so let's talk about that a little bit. So first of all, folks, everybody that listens to this show, all two of you, if you would be so kind as we would like your input on this subject, and we will continue the conversation, because in our, I think, Reverend, you and I, our estimation, this is a serious subject. I mean, we have a serious problem in this state.
Yeah.
So first of all, I completely agree with you about the fact that it is a financially based decision. I believe Terry Branstad, Governor Branstad, is making a financial decision. That's the kind of guy he is. He's has always been a black and white, okay, numbers kind of guy. That's the reason the university, Des Moines University, hired him to run that. He's a financial guy. He's a smart guy, okay? Besides any other opinions, he's really a smart guy. And he's looking at the last two facilities that he's closing down for that reason. Mm-hmm. Financially, what's it going to cost us to revamp these two facilities? Millions and millions and millions of dollars. The staff that goes along with it, millions and millions and millions of dollars. And he's saying, look, it's a tough call, but I've got to close them. Okay, so let's accept that, shall we? Just for the moment, let's just accept that and go, good job, Terry, you're closing them down. The question that comes, and I don't have an answer for this, is how do we pull the slack? My friend committed suicide last week. Could there have been somebody there to have helped him? Should he have been put into some sort of a program or facility? I don't know, but the fact of the matter is, if I'm in trouble right now, mentally I'm having trouble, I'm telling myself I can't live another day, where do I go?
Right.
Where do I go that I can get help and talk to somebody? Of course, friends and family, pastors, priests, whatever, but where can I go to get professional help? Well, the hospitals do offer that. The hospitals do offer psychiatric wards. You can check yourself in. I happen to know that. I had a friend years and years and years ago, had thoughts of committing suicide, checked himself into Lutheran Hospital. They had a mental health or psychiatric ward over there, and I think all of them do. So I'm going, all right, we have the ability for them to go someplace, right?
And if you have insurance, your insurance is going to cover.
There you go.
And then again, here comes that question. Only because I know some people that when they do that, well, how much does that insurance cover?
Mental health guidelines are relatively limited on most health insurance plans. You're hitting the nail on the head here. Now, here's the problem. Here's the problem. My friend is the example. Pisses me off. Okay. He's lost like 50, 60 pounds in a short period of time. Jimmy, if you lost 50, 60 pounds in the next 6 weeks, seriously, son, I'm going to be talking to you because there isn't any diet other than starvation that's going to let you do that. Okay.
Exactly.
There's no magic pill. All right. There's no magic that you can do. I'm going to sit down and go, Jimmy, what's going on? Have you been to the doctor? And see, my friend went to the doctors, went to the hospitals. Ain't nothing wrong with you. Go home.
Right.
They didn't take it serious enough. Look, there's a problem. Whether it's mental, what do they call it, physiological or mental, there was a problem here. Admit his ass. He had health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
If he didn't, we still have something to back that up. Go to Broadlawns.
Mm-hmm.
Broadlawns is one of the finest county hospitals that I've ever seen. I mean, it really is a good hospital. You can say what you want to about it, but it really is a good facility.
They've turned it around compared to what it used to
be exactly right.
Years ago.
Yeah, you that have the opinions, that's because you're old and you're thinking 40 years ago. Mm-hmm. They have actually, that is a great facility. Are you going to sit next to somebody that barely can eke out a living? Yeah. So what?
Well, here's the other piece of that. As you said, being, you know, a friend or a family of this person, you know there's something that's wrong. They went to a doctor, like you said. The doctor says they're fine. You know, I mean, I've got a friend, you know, they're saying that they ended up on medication and they think it's great. Well, you know, I don't know that that's the end all be all, but depending on where you are in the situation that you are in, that you probably need that to get through the situation you are. But here's the key. You know your friend went to the doctor. The doctor said there's nothing wrong. Well, number one, get there to try and have those conversations with your friend.
Be there for them.
Number two, go to the doctor with them. Mm-hmm. And if you can, go back. And if the doctor says, well, you're fine, you'd be like, no, doc.
Time out.
No.
Yeah.
You don't live around him, her every day.
Jimmy, you're right on target. Go ahead. You're right there.
We are noticing something.
Yeah.
I mean, at this point, it's not an intervention for the friend. At this point, it's an intervention of the doctor going.
That's exactly it.
Dude, I don't care who's lining your pocket with whatever it is, or you're not going to get a kickback. I mean, I don't know why. I don't know what the aversion is to doctors to I mean, you're practicing medicine anyway, so practice.
Yeah. Let me tell you something, Jimmy. You hit the nail on the head. You got a friend that's got a problem. There's my friend was divorced mm-hmm. by himself. Go with him. Say, dude, I'm going to go with you. Let me sit in the room with you. I am your friend. I'm going to be your support system here. And I may hear something that you don't hear.
Mm-hmm.
Or I may be able to look at the doctor and say, doc, I appreciate your great vast knowledge, but you ain't with this guy every week. You don't see him go to church. You don't see him on his job where he's suffering. I do. Let me tell you what I've experienced, which, by the way, Mrs. McRoberts and I do that.
Mm-hmm.
She goes with me on most of my doctor's visits because I'll miss something. Or she can just be brutally honest and say, no, he does not do that. And the doctor goes, okay. And I've seen that happen. There's another problem. My friend, I believe, and I don't know if he got off of it or not, was prescribed a drug called, I believe it's Adderall.
Mm-hmm.
Adderall is the most despicable, I don't know if that's the right word, disgusting, terrible drug that I've ever seen. And there are report after freaking report of individuals that took Adderall, and there have been suicides after it. I happen to have a couple of family members that went on this stuff, and they went badass crazy, walking around in their front yard, looking, howling at the moon. I mean, bad, bad. Now, that's the flip side of this. We're covering a whole lot of subjects. We can focus on any one of them, but doctors are just prescribing crap to prescribe crap, okay? That
or,
was not
or
the answer.
They're not.
Or they're not prescribing anything, sending them home and not doing anything. So now they're left out in the cold, and they felt despondent before they walked into the damn office. Now they get sent home and go, I don't know what's wrong with you. You ain't nothing wrong with you. You're fine. Now there's double despondent.
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. Go to DebtProdigy.com and referred by as you're filling out the form there, put Jimmy Olsen. Again, you're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. And Rooster, you're right. I mean, you've got two wide areas here. And then something else that we were discussing when we were off air, kind of getting everything prepped for this, is there's two people that are also being ignored with these closings. And that is, number one, the people that are in jail, that yes. it's more of a mental issue.
Yes.
But there's no place for them to yes. go, so they're in prison.
Yes.
Now there's, because I do a lot with, some homeless shelters, and I have friends that deal with that. And I've got a lot of friends that deal on the mental health side.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got now these people that are under a bridge, they're homeless because... You know, going back to what we said earlier in the program where people were just ignoring them and like, oh, drama queen, you're just looking for attention. Well, they just need to go out and get a job. Well, guess what? If they have a mental problem, they cannot get a job.
They can't function.
Right.
They have function problems. You know,
and some of that even falls into the vets that have this issue.
You've got the PTSD issues. And you know, for a good number of years, I sat back because I had a father that served in Korea. I had other family, an uncle that was a tail gunner in World War II. I mean, saw his buddies killed time and time again, and he functioned through the rest. But you knew that they had issues. Okay, back in those days, you just don't talk about them. Okay,
that's something right there too.
Exactly,
we don't talk about it.
And look, here's the thing: the jails, the homeless. We as a society have to be given the opportunity to step up to the plate. Now, I'm not saying that, Kirby, you need to take in five homeless people. I'm not saying that. And the reason I'm not saying that is because you're not qualified, okay, to take care of those folks. Now, if you have an aunt or an uncle that has problems and you need to take them in because they've lost everything, they live in a car, that's different, okay? Mm-hmm. But you're not qualified because of mental health issues. Some of these folks are volatile, okay? They don't want to hurt anybody, not really. Not really, but they can be volatile. So you have to have individuals that are prepared for that volatile emotional roller coaster that they may go on. And so my question is to our listeners is, how do we fix that problem? Where do we find the money mm-hmm. to engage and build buildings or facilities and staff those facilities with individuals that understand this. Secondarily, what is a level of protocol that we can do to help those folks where they go into a facility, say they go into one of our local hospitals, and they can get the proper diagnosis without just trying to run them through like herding cattle. Mm-hmm. And part of the reason that we do herd them like cattle is while our healthcare costs for premiums is going up, the amount of money that's getting passed through to the doctors and the facilities is becoming less.
Right.
They're cutting them back. No, you can't have that drug. Prescribe them something else. And so how do we fund that, Jim? I mean, how do we put enough money away to do that? Would I be willing to give another $10 a year into a fund? And if we took everybody in the state of Iowa, we're just talking about Iowa here. Remember I talked earlier, start on your state level, start on your city level, right?
Right.
Would I be willing to give $10 a year into a fund? Why not? Mm-hmm. Seems like an oversimplification, but it seems pretty simple to me. Why not put that $10 in?
Which then, of course, then it gets complicated because you take that, they put it into that fund, but you got to make sure that those that are in their positions leave that in the fund that it's there for and not borrow it for something else.
Therein lies the problems, okay?
Right.
And that's why we at the state and local and state level both have to vote in those individuals that we feel are the most competent, honest to run those accounts. So what I'd like to leave with everybody, and I'm going to share an idea that Mrs. McRoberts shared with me this weekend, because she and I both have been affected. Mm-hmm. This fellow was her friend too. And we really have been affected by this. She said, "Why didn't you take Doc?" And I'll mention his name. He won't mind. Dr. Pat. Mm-hmm. Pat Matrosh. Pat Matrosh is a friend of ours, has been for years. One of the best doctors helping folks with mental health and issues and things like that. The guy's brilliant. Mm-hmm. He's crazy as a loon, yet he's still brilliant. Okay? I mean, this is, I love him. Blinn and I, both, Mrs. McRoberts and I both love him. And she said, why wouldn't you call him up and say, "Doc, I got to go see a friend. I think there's a problem. Mm-hmm. Will you ride with me?" I checked. He said, "Sure." I had to ask. I said, I can't. We're not going to pay." He said, "I don't need to be paid."
Right.
I mean, he was going there, would have gone there.
Mm-hmm.
So, folks, if you know somebody, you have a friend that's a trained professional. Okay. And again, it's probably going to have to be one of your friends if you have one. Here's what I'm leaving you with in this subject. A couple of points. First of all, I'd love to know how we can fund to better serve our communities for those that have mental health issues, to get them out of the jail system, which would save us, or at least we could redirect those dollars, right, out of the homeless shelters. How do we help these folks? And the second thing is err on the side that somebody's got a problem if you think they have a problem, and be happy if you're wrong.
And I mean, we are going kind of to the extreme, which we can have conversation on our Facebook page. Listening to this, go to Rooster McRoberts, the Facebook page, where the show is actually posted there, and you can make your comments below
Love it.
And again, remember, you can always subscribe to this on iTunes, and then whenever there's a new program, it comes out. But here's something else. And you know what? I'm one who busts the church's chops all the time.
Yeah, you do.
Because I think churches need to do more.
I don't disagree.
And I mean, even an example of, I mean, there's some bigger church. I mean, with the Catholic Church and the Catholic Charities, I mean, with Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, but they also have groups.
Yep.
And maybe it's not even, maybe you've got a friend that, you know, they're not to that extreme, or you get them early enough. Maybe it's not even one to have a conversation with a doctor. It's just, "Hey, you know, they've got this group we can go to. How about I take you to the group?" Now, do I think there are some churches that could step up a little more with this? Absolutely.
Sure.
Are these ran by doctors? No. These are ran by guys like Rooster and myself that have the same issues, that have the same things that are fighting in our minds. That just, again, able to have those conversations with a like-minded individual to reach out. It's that first step to get the help. Not saying that that's the end-all, be-all, because maybe you need more than that. but it's a start.
So you're taking friend. Responsibility for your neighbors and friends mm-hmm. by doing that. And I have to tell you, Jimmy, you're right. That should be the first step. And those groups, mm-hmm. 8 or 10 people, I know we make fun of them on TV, you know, the mm-hmm. alcoholic group and drug group and all this. But let me tell you something. I have another friend in this town, actually two of them. One that has been clean and sober for many years. The other one had serious, serious alcohol problems. And this friend of ours got him to start going to a support group.
Mm-hmm.
Guess what? Guess what? Clean and sober now for, I guess, maybe 5+ years.
Mm-hmm.
Outstanding. Hallelujah. Right? Mm-hmm. But I think that you're absolutely right. We personally have to take some level of responsibility for our friends and neighbors and not shovel it off to everybody else. Pastors, mm-hmm. take responsibility for the sheep in your shepherdship or whatever you want
to
call it.
But it also doesn't mean that you're beating them over the head and shoving something down their throat.
You've got to do this
out of compassion. You've got to do this out of love.
Yeah.
No,
exactly.
And that's the other issue.
Absolutely. Don't beat people up. You're a drunk. No, don't do that.
You know, honestly, and I'll admit to it, I hung my hat on this for years because I grew up hearing about it, even in church. You know, tough love. You know, tough love is crap. It's unconditional love, and it doesn't matter, you know, what the person's done, who the person is.
That's right.
They need you to be there.
Wrap your arms around them and love them through this. And there's sometimes when you have to look at them and sternly say, no, you can't do that. That's
right.
Different.
Right.
That tough love stuff, I get it.
Ignore them and walk away. No.
No. You've got to embrace the person that's having the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Tell them that you're there for them to lean on and that you are available. Again, we have become a society of it. I don't care. We have become a society of if it takes my time, you're infringing upon my life.
It's not my problem.
It's not. That's the class. It's not my problem. 4 words that suck.
Right.
It's not my problem.
And guess what? It will become your problem.
Absolutely. Because guess what? Somebody's going to have to pay for it.
Or something's going to happen to a friend. They're going to do something.
There you
it's
go.
It's going to hurt.
Much, which is the most serious part of it.
You're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Thank to Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. DebtProdigy.com. As you're filling out the form there, I put there referred by Jimmy Olson to give Rooster and myself credit for helping them out. Again, you're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. A little bit of a more serious subject that we've had. But before we go, I want to... I'm going to leave you with some stuff here.
No, Leah, let's
see what kind of a high note it is.
We'll see.
All right. So here's a phrase for you. Okay. Over the top. You've heard over the top.
Yeah. You're over the top.
You know where that came from?
I have no idea.
It came from soldiers going over the top of trenches in World War I. They were going over the top.
Makes perfectly good sense.
Do you know why? Talk music for a minute. They have the top 40, top 40 songs.
Yeah.
And, of course, Billboard, you know, end up being the top 100, blah, blah, blah. But do you reason why that they were top 40 songs?
Now, that is an interesting point, and it has to do with the time to play a song in some way, right?
No.
Okay, tell me what it is.
Jukeboxes. Original jukeboxes only held 40 records.
That's cool.
Round things with holes. It's like a donut that you can't eat, kids.
Yeah.
They only held 40 records.
And that's how the top 40 came up.
Yeah.
That is kind of neat.
And Best Buy. You know that they had a name before that.
Best Buy had a name before.
Before they were Best Buy.
Ms. Kirby, do you know what it was? I don't either.
Sound of Music. I think they were also, you know, born in the Appalachian. I don't know.
That's silly. Sound of Music?
Yeah, Sound of Music, yeah.
That is not even a...
And I think...
business name, really.
No, it's a movie.
Yeah, exactly. Did they get sued?
Who knows? Her name's Julie Andrews. I think, you know, she sang her jingle.
Right. Well, you know, that's interesting where things come from, because I do get interested in where did that little tagline come from, and just add one that's hilarious. The rails on a railroad track for trains are like 8 foot center to center.
Okay.
Do you know where that came from, why it was chosen 8 foot? You would think, well, we built a locomotive and it just ended up being 8 feet, right?
Right, yeah.
The truth of the matter is that's the exact width of a chariot.
Really?
From Roman times. So Romans set the stage for how wide a train track is.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Fascinating information.
We're not, and we don't even put chariots on tracks.
Obviously not. Obviously not. I wouldn't be surprised I see you in the city of Des Moines with a chariot. However, I did see a guy on Facebook, because I'm a Harley rider.
Right.
And he had actually taken his motorcycle and reconfigured it. And rather than have a sidecar, him in a seat and then a sidecar, he took the seat off, no sidecar, built a chariot and connected it to his motorcycle. It was standing up, going down the street like it's a chariot. Yeah. This is the coolest thing. I wouldn't buy one, but I thought it was cool. It's really pretty funny.
All right, I'll give you two more things before we let everybody go. First one, NBC. We were chatting about them earlier. NBC split itself into two networks in the 1920s and 1930s. They had the red network for more expensive shows and the blue network for cheaper ones.
Really?
The FCC made them divide into two separate companies in 1939, and the blue network became ABC.
I'll be darned. I didn't know that. That's fascinating. Tidbits of information, folks, that you didn't know and could care less that you got the information.
Six Flags Over America. Six Flags. You know the amusement park?
Sure.
How did they get their name?
I know there's six flags over Texas.
Right,
six,
right. Well, so six flags. This is where it's coming. So
I thought
six
it was
flags,
seven flags.
Six. Is it seven flags?
Yeah.
Okay, whatever. I don't care. Six Flags. Anyway, Six Flags got its name of the six different nations Texas has been a part of. Yeah, Six Flags Over Texas. We need seven flags. Will you stop? Now you're just screwing
with me. It's Seven Flags Fitness Center in the city of Des Moines, folks.
Well,
I'm trying
anymore.
To mess with him. Yeah, it's gone too, isn't it?
But they still have the event center, though. Seven Flags. Yeah. Yeah. No, Six Flags. So it was from the six different nations. So Spain, France, Mexico, the Republic of Texas, the United States, and the Confederacy. Six Flags Over Texas.
Outstanding information that will help us get through this week without any trouble at all. Well done, Reverend.
It will give them something to talk about over the water cooler, because that's what we do. We give you the most useless information to say, you know what? I know something.
Look, we on some things we get serious. Today we're a little bit serious, but most of the time we're just having a good time, having a conversation, give you something. We are entertainment.
We try to be, even if it's ourselves.
We do entertain ourselves.
Rooster, thank you very much, sir. So until next time.
Right.
You are listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster from the DebtProdigy.com studios. Debt Prodigy helps you track all your expenses, spending and expenses, create and manage your budget, manage all your financial account, and Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com. Go check it out. Until next time, have a marvelous, fantastic. You look marvelous. Whatever. You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster.